Welcome to Law Sessions. I am Jennifer Howson. In this law session on the English legal system, we are going to focus on the sources of law in the English legal system. Where does the law come from? What is it that deals with, or really, what is it that one looks to when you are in the English legal system for the law? Now, in the first law session, of course, we just looked at what law was, what is the idea behind it. And certainly in other law sessions, you will see what is precedent. You look at the courts, you will look at the idea of statutory interpretation. But here we're looking at where the courts and the judges and even the citizen go to when they consider the law. They are various. However, what we will consider are the main sources. And in this particular law session, the ones we will be covering are the European Union. We will look at statutes. We will look at delegated legislation. We will look at cases, and we will look at custom. Those are the main ones that we will focus on. There are others, of course. Certainly when you look at even a persuasive authority from other jurisdictions, this might be a basis for a source of law. But for all intents and purposes, those are the ones that I'll look at, and we will look at them in some depth. Let's start off then with European Union law. Now, when you look at the European Union as a source of law in England and Wales, the point is that it was not until 1972 that we see the UK becoming a member of, seeing the UK passing legislation which sort of gave credibility to them joining the European Union. And that is in the form of the European Communities Act of 1972. Now, based on this membership, the idea is that the European Union law, insofar as it has to do with matters within the competency of the EU, they, of course, meaning the European Union, they have the ability to impact UK law. So since the UK became a member of the European Union, then it has, to a degree, passed a certain amount of its power in respect of legislative creation, in respect of creating laws which have an effect in the UK. So when you look at the UK's legislative, executive, and judicial powers, they are now to some extent controlled by and can only be operated within the framework of European Union law. Now again, as I say, it is only in the competences that go to the EU. What are those competences? Well, there are four. You have got to consider, for example, free movement of goods, free movement of workers, establishment and services, capital. The idea being that if there is a matter of community law which comes before the court in the UK, then the jurisprudence, the case law from the Court of Justice of the EU is important in that decision. Now, this causes sometimes a little bit of a problem for law students because they start thinking, well, hang on, isn't the Supreme Court the highest court in the land, and therefore, how does community law? Well, you have to understand the framework of EU law, because when the UK became a member, then it signed up to certain obligations. And the idea is that under the Treaty of Rome, all of the member states who have become part of the EU have, to a degree, given up some of their sovereignty, meaning we talk about Parliament having the supreme legislative approach when it comes to laws. Only Parliament can pass a law in the UK. However, when you look, for example, at the EU, the idea is that the case law coming out of the EU, and in particular, a very important case called Van Gendenloos and the Netherlands, it says that the EU is now a new legal order when it comes to the dealings between member states and the European Union. So the idea is that when you consider laws from an international perspective, countries are either monist or dualist, meaning if it's a monist state, then international law comes in once the executive signs it. Because make no mistake, when, for example, the prime minister or the like signs a treaty, an international treaty, it doesn't necessarily mean that it automatically becomes law when he goes back to his own country. It depends on whether the state has a monist system in terms of its lawmaking or dualist. Now, monist, once you sign it, it automatically becomes law. If you're a dualist state, which is like the UK and most Commonwealth countries, then the legislature, in this case Parliament, has to pass legislation which then takes account of that international law. The problem with the EU framework is that it says that the Treaty of Rome does not take on board this whole monist dualist distinction. Rather, it is a new legal order, one where the member states have, for all intents and purposes, given up some of their sovereignty. It means that when you look at community law, then depending on the nature and source of the type of EU legislation, it may have what is called direct effect on the domestic laws of the member states. And what that means is that it may be open to an individual to rely on EU law in front of its national court without the need for any particular statutes to be made at national level. So what that means is a piece of legislation passed at EU level may have direct effect. And all that means is an individual can rely on it in front of their national court. Now, this idea of direct effect, of course, gives that strong impact when it comes to EU law. Because by virtue of me being able to go in front of a court and say, well, there is this piece of legislation, which is a regulation, for example, I can rely on it in front of my court. That, of course, then means that EU law has given a specific piece of legislation which did not have to go before Parliament. So when you look at EU law, there is, of course, the treaty itself, which is the main type of law, then the primary source. Then, of course, you have things like regulations coming out of the EU. You have directives. These are the forms that the legislation take. Now, when you look at regulations, I can, as an individual in my member state, rely on a regulation which is passed at the EU today. I can rely on it because, of course, it has direct effect. Now, when you look at other types of legislation, so articles of the treaty, or when you look at directives, they may have direct effect, but it depends. You need to understand vertical direct effect and horizontal direct effect. Vertical direct effect simply means that a person can rely on a piece of EU legislation when he seeks to bring an action against the state in which he lives. And horizontal direct effect means that he can rely on it if he is seeking to bring an action against another legal person within his member state. So horizontal direct effect says, I can sue you based on EU law. Vertical direct effect means I can sue my country based on EU law. Now, when you look at the source of EU law, there are basically four types that you can generally put your hands on. You have the internal treaties and the protocols. So these, of course, govern member states of the EU, and anything contained within them, of course, supersedes inconsistent domestic legal provisions. I can't stress this enough, because a lot of times students will say EU law overrides national law. That's not strictly true. EU law overrides inconsistent national law, and only in the areas for which EU law is competent in the member state. So as we say, you have the main treaty, but there have been various amending treaties. So the Single European Act in 1986, the Treaty of Maastricht in 1992, we have the Treaty of Amsterdam, we have the Treaty of Nice, and most recently, of course, the Treaty of Lisbon. All of these have either amended and or renumbered the original EC treaty. Now, when the UK joined, then what we see is that in order to incorporate EU law within national legislation, we see that they had to, of course, ensure that a piece of legislation was passed. And that, of course, was the ECA 1972, the European Communities Act 1972. And it allows EU law to have vertical and horizontal effect, but there are limitations. So, for example, I can't just say I am relying on the treaty for my rights, because I can't rely on the treaty in its entirety. What I can rely on is an article of the treaty which gives me a right. So let's say, for example, I needed to export food from England to France, and they are putting a tax on it simply because it's going across borders. Then I can bring an action to say that that restricts my free movement rights in respect of goods. So I may more or less look to have an action being brought. And in that regard, I may very well say, well, the treaty article in relation to free movement gives me a right because it meets certain criteria, as was set down in the case of Van Gendenlos, which says if it's clear, precise, and unconditional, and you don't need anything else in order to put in it into national law, then that's fine. So that's the idea. The second way that we see international law, of course, being coming on board, or indeed EU law, is where you have international agreements. And these, of course, are when they are negotiated or agreed to by the EU countries within the framework. Secondary legislation, which is now under Article 288 of the Treaty of the Functioning of the EU, which used to be Article 249, under the TEU, which was the Maastricht when it was renumbered, that provides for secondary legislation in the form of regulations, directives, recommendations, and opinions, and these act as a source of law from the EU. Equally, when you look at judgments of the Court of Justice of the EU, this is one area that has been very prolific in allowing a basis as it relates to a source. Now, under Article 267 of the TFEU, which was previously Article 234, we see that a member state court can ask for a preliminary reference in respect of a piece of case or even legislation in the member state at the Court of Justice of the EU. And the Court of Justice will respond to that. Now, where does the Court of Justice, or indeed the whole EU framework, gets its authority? Well, Section 2.1 of the European Communities Act gives them that. So what we see is that by and large, the EU is a major source, and the legislation coming out of the EU, together with the case law, provide for a very solid foundation when it comes to matters relating to EU law competence. That, though, is only one source. We're going to take a short break, And as soon as we return, we will carry on by looking at the remaining bases or sources of law within the English legal system.